Hello, everybody. Listen, I'd like to welcome one of our guests today. So as last week, we were talking about we're going to have one of our lawyers with us this week. Mr. Perry, welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome to the show, and thank you for taking your time from your very busy schedule and being here with us. So today, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to talk about what is the role of a real estate lawyer in the real estate industry. So I'm gonna try to ask Mr. Perry some questions, and hopefully we have enough time to get the most out of him in a very short period of time. So Mr. Perry, again, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Thank you again. So can you please give us some of the roles that as a real estate lawyer, what's the involvement, like what's the process that you guys do when it comes to basically a buyer and a seller transaction that's involved in the real estate industry?
Yeah, of course. So thank you very much, Mateen. Thank you for having me on today.
Thank you.
Yeah, my name is Perry Benipal. I'm from the law firm of Papazian Hazy Myers. We're a team of 12 lawyers. We're basically a full-service firm. We're in downtown. We're at King & York. We do a lot of real estate transactions. As you know, the market has been quite busy this year with lots of buying, selling, and now we're going into the fourth quarter, so lots of refinancing happening.
I think it's being crazy, not busy.
Yeah, you can say that it's been crazy. We've seen prices skyrocket, and it looked like, based on the recent trend and the news, you know, the prime rate is going to stay the same. So we'll probably see the same type of inflation in real estate as we've seen previously.
Okay.
And so thank you for having me on today. And we're going to be discussing purchase sale transactions mainly. As you know, the market's been very, very good. Lots of people selling, lots of people buying. So I guess we'll just jump right into it.
Yeah.
We'll start with a purchase transaction. Okay. So unlike a conventional transaction, what happens in real estate is the agreement of purchase and sale, as you know, the AREA standard form, it lands on the lawyer's desk fully signed. And so it's very, very important to have a good real estate agent like yourself, right? We want to make sure that the client's wishes are fulfilled in the agreement. Majority of the time, we can't really change the agreement or make any amendments once it lands on our desk. So as soon as the agreement lands on our desk from the agent, the first thing we do is we see who our client is. We're going to quickly run a conflict check. And then the next thing we're looking at is basically if the legal description matches what the actual municipal address is of the property. Most of the time those things are okay. Realtors are using Geo Warehouse. The municipal address and the legal description usually always match. Then we're going to check when the closing date is. I'll give you an example. Closing date is very important. We recently had a transaction land on our desk where the closing date was supposed to be November 22nd, 2021. But there was an error, and it said November 22nd, 2022.
Oh, wow.
So now, in that situation, obviously the seller doesn't want to wait that long because, it's real estate. The prices are going to go up, and the buyer's happy to wait that long because they got a great deal. They got a 2021 house at 2022 prices. So that's what we look at next. We look at the closing date. We make sure it's in line with what the client wants, what the agents have agreed to, and all that is good. Next, we're looking at deposits and if the deposits have been paid. Standard agreement provides that deposits must be paid, as you know, within 24 hours. So we verify that those deposits have been paid and we look at the purchase price. Next thing we're looking at is the title search date. We look at the title search date. Now, what that gives us is the date that the lawyer is required to search title by. So on that date, what happens is we go into the land registry system of Ontario. We go ahead and we put in the address of the property, and we pull what's called the PIN page to the property. Now, the PIN page is going to list basically all the dealings that have happened with the property. If the client, if the seller's got a mortgage on it, it's going to be there. Any transfers they've done, and anything that's been done, typically since the last 40 years is going to be on that page.
Perry, in terms of the title search that you just talked about, how many days is sufficient enough prior to closing that you need to do the title search? Because sometimes people are always asking me when we do put the time, they're like, what's this? Like, how does that work?
So we typically recommend 2 weeks before the closing date.
Okay.
We don't want to do the title search too early because, you know, anything can happen in that time period and somebody else can register something on title that we're not aware of, and then it can cause hiccups in our closing.
Can a week also be sufficient enough for you?
Yes, a week is sufficient. You do recommend 2 weeks, but a week is more than sufficient.
Okay.
The only issues we have sometimes is there's a closing in November and the title search date lists in August.
Okay.
Right? What we're going to be doing then is basically...
So basically you're saying that during that period of time, you want to make sure that nothing else is taking place against the title of the property.
That's absolutely correct.
Okay.
Yeah, we want to make sure that nothing else happens to the property. And the reason being is the main purpose of having a lawyer involved in the real estate transaction is to ensure that the buyer is delivered free and clear title. Many times, if a seller hasn't paid taxes, there will be a tax lien on the property. Tax liens take priorities over mortgages. Tax liens, cities can enforce them against the current owner of the home, not the one who owes the taxes.
Okay.
So we want to ensure those things, you know, they don't pop up on title.
Or any other lien or encumbrances that's going to be involved, right?
Exactly.
So, like, for instance, like a second mortgage or someone else has, they, like, bought some sort of appliance or something. So instead of, you know, on a personal, people could also put a lien on the property.
That's absolutely okay. Correct.
And so that 1 week to 2 weeks maximum, you're saying it's quite sufficient, but you don't want other, you're basically, so for our audience to know, do not go like a month or 2 months or 3 months.
Exactly.
When it comes to a title search.
Exactly.
Okay.
And you know, sometimes the agreement lands on our desk, and that is the case, that it's, you know, 2 months before. So then it's incumbent on the lawyer, and, you know, majority of them do, they'll do the title search, you know, just 2 weeks ahead of closing, just to double check if everything's okay and nothing has been registered.
Okay.
Yeah. Again, things that are registered on title don't usually run with the owner, they run with the property.
Okay.
So if we have, you know, a lien, a mortgage that's registered on the property and it's not supposed to be, it's not, you can't point the finger and say, no, it was the previous owner. It's going to be the current owner because those things are running with the title to the property. So it's very, very important, the title search, aspect of it. And then moving on from the title search, what we're going to look at next, chattels and fixtures, as you know.
Okay.
So we look at chattels and fixtures, which are included and which are excluded. You know, usually the case is we get the standard fridge, stove, and all these things. Recently, we've been doing quite voluminous transactions, purchase prices exceeding $3 million. In that type of situation, we've noticed and we do recommend, okay, you know, if you're purchasing a property with a large purchase price and there's a Wolf appliance, you want to make sure you write down Wolf stove, Wolf fridge, because you don't want to just write down stove.
With the serial numbers.
With the serial numbers, as recommended.
Yeah,
yes,
yeah.
Yes.
So sometimes what we do, actually, myself and the team, we take pictures of the appliances and we write down the serial numbers, especially when it comes to properties like, you know, like custom homes or any type of property that's over $1 million. And if the appliances are... like brand names, because a lot of times I have noticed, not a lot of times, sorry.
you don't want to give the wrong
couple message. Of times, actually, I have noticed this year that happened to us, the client called and is like, Mateen, the appliances are gone.
Yep.
But they said fridge and stove, but they didn't specify exactly what type of fridge and stove and maker model. So they exchanged it. So for some of our audience, and, you know, it's always good, please advise your real estate agent to take the photos and put the serial number of the appliances if they are expensive, okay, or brand names, right?
Or even if they're not expensive, just, you know, as a good measure.
And a good measure.
I love your idea of the pictures, right? Because these days, you take pictures on your phone, you get a time stamp, you know, and you get a date stamp. So if anything comes down to it, you say to the lawyer, hey, you know, I did my final inspection yesterday, but this is what I saw that day, but that's not in the property anymore.
Correct.
Right.
Or sometimes they even take them.
Yeah.
Sometimes they, like, you don't even end up with one, right?
Yeah. And it's a horrible situation. And in an ideal world, these things wouldn't happen. However, we're not in an ideal world.
Okay.
Right. So we that is part of the lawyer's role as well. You know, I always recommend to my clients, hey, once you've done your final inspection, give me a call. Just make sure everything's okay, right? If there are any issues, let the lawyers just try and resolve it at that point. I'll give you an example, like, you know, things like a microwave or something might, you know, not be working or something like that. A simple $50 credit, and that's not going to affect the buyer or the seller, and they're happy with that, is going to resolve the problem, right? So it's very important to keep the lawyer informed about these things and in the loop. Even if the clients, you know, they're sending an email to their agent, they can always loop in their lawyer to just, you know, keep them updated and keep them informed of the process.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. So what else do we have to be like really aware of besides the title search? Now we talked about what else that are very crucial and important.
Yeah, of course. So we want to, you know, the standard ARIA form provides a lot of generic information, a lot of good information. ARIA standard form provides that vacant possession is to be given on closing.
Okay.
You know, now we're good jumping into the clauses. If vacant possession is not to be given and the current owner wants the tenants to stay, and the new owner wants to assume them, those need to be added into the clauses, along with, you know, the standard financing condition, inspection condition as well. The ARIA standard form provides for an inspection. However, it can be waived in the clauses. So it's very, very important that, you know, we have those. You got your financing, you got your inspection. You want to make sure that if there's a tenant in there and the new buyer wants the tenant to stay, it needs to be specified in the agreement. So just on the safe side, is this a rule of thumb that I recommend? Anything that you can think of that you want the property to be in this state or you want this to happen, it's always important just to mention it in the clauses. I'll give you an example. Sometime I had a transaction where there's a couple of holes in the walls, right? And the buyer-seller, you know, they agreed a handshake agreement, right?
Yeah.
Oh, we will fix the holes.
Yeah.
But it wasn't in the APS.
Yeah.
So then when we closed and the holes are still there, mm-hmm. right? Okay. Handshake agreements don't form a contract unless you're going to go all the way and get an order to enforce that, right?
Okay. So basically what you're saying that so whatever that we want
yeah.
to accomplish or to do, you want to make sure that that is on the agreement.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Very well said. You're absolutely right. And this is a lot of times people do make the mistake. They're like, well, you know what? The seller promised to fix these issues. But, you know, and during the time that we're taking the possession of the property yeah. and they're not complete. Right, and sometimes they actually call us and they're like, "Well, Mateen, why did this and this such and such didn't take place?" Mm-hmm. But for us, we're always. I tell my clients and our buyer's agent that please, if there's anything that needs to be complete prior to closing, please make sure it's written on Schedule A. Okay, write it down. Take the buyer's initial and seller's, and make sure. Before closing, try to do a couple of days before the closing date, go back and make sure that those issues are solved and complete. Okay? So that's actually...
And I couldn't have said it better myself.
Yeah.
You know, you just...
Very well said, yeah.
Again, in a perfect world, you know, sometimes it's not the intent of a seller to do such a thing, but yeah. it just happens, right?
Yeah.
So what we want to do is we want to try to avoid those things, avoid those pitfalls people
For
fall
sure.
into. And, you know, just if it's on the contract, there's an obligation to abide by the contract.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. So what else do you think that... now, I'm also... Let me ask you a question. A lot of times people are saying that, well, Mateen, I like to keep myself on title instead of my spouse.
Yeah.
Right? So is there a benefit in terms of that? So if a husband and wife are going into a title, I know that sometimes, so when it comes up to like a matrimonial home, obviously, mm-hmm. right? I don't think it makes a difference if it's a husband or a wife will go on title. So a lot of our audiences... have send us like emails and texting us. He goes, Mateen, I want to know what's the difference if between me or my spouse, like if we could be both on title or just one of us. Is there a difference between that?
So from
when
the
it comes down to title, by the way,
from the lawyer's perspective, when yeah. it comes down to title to a matrimonial home, no conveyance or anything for that matter can be done to the property without spousal consent.
Okay.
So strictly from a legal standpoint, and I'll leave the financial standpoint to one side because I'm not going to comment on that, but
yeah.
from a legal standpoint, anything that needs to happen with regards to a matrimonial home requires spousal consent.
Okay.
So there may be, you know, financial implications that one may want to abide by and do that and not have the other spouse on title. But when it comes to dealing with that property, when it comes to getting a mortgage on that property, when it comes to selling that property, you know, if you have a house and it's in your name, until your wife comes in and signs the paper saying that you can get this mortgage or you can sell this house, as a lawyer, I can't do it.
Okay. Yeah. But so spousal consent is basically needed when it's a matrimonial home.
That is correct.
Which means that both the husband and wife are living in one property.
That's correct.
So the one that's who's also not on title, does the other spouse have 50% ownership of the property?
Well, that's usually the starting point. Now, so we're deviating a little bit from real estate, touching onto family law, but you're absolutely correct. The starting point is a 50-50 split.
Okay.
And there's arguments, you know, if it comes down to it and there's an argument and you're going towards, you know, separation or divorce, then yes, you'll have to see what was brought in and what was done, who was paying the mortgage, who was paying the expenses, and there will be equalization payments, if you understand what I'm saying. But the starting point is at 50-50, yes.
Oh, okay, great. And so, Perry, let me also ask you a question regarding first-time home buyer program.
Yeah.
For us, we also have a first-time home buying program. Sometimes people are asking us, he goes, well, Mateen, we are, you know, legible for, like, you know, for this amount of money. Mm-hmm. What is the percentage for a first-time home buyer that they receive? What are the benefits of it? And when in a household, let's just, for instance, if we have four people that wants to go on title, what's the benefit of for them?
Yeah, of course. And so the first-time home buyer tax credit is what you're referring to.
Exactly.
So there's two in the province of Ontario. Well, I shouldn't say the province of Ontario because one is for the city of Toronto. So the province of Ontario, so Doug Ford, basically, he will give you a rebate of $4,000 if you're a first-time home buyer on the land transfer tax.
Okay.
And basically what's going to happen is, as a lawyer, we sit with the client, we ask them, hey, are you a first-time home buyer, meaning you haven't purchased property anywhere in Canada or anywhere else around the world, and they sign an affidavit to that extent as well. Now, in the city of Toronto, there's also a first-time home buyer rebate. Now, that one is $4,475, and you get a credit off your, you know, the land transfer tax that you would have to pay to the City of Toronto.
Okay.
As you know, in the City of Toronto, if you're buying a property, you're paying two land transfer tax. One goes to the City of Toronto, and the other one goes to the province of Ontario. If you're buying a city just outside, anywhere outside of Toronto and in Ontario, it's just going to be the Ontario land transfer tax. So an important, what you hinted to was basically, hey, you know, a typical scenario. Mother, father, and let's say daughter and son are going on title to a home. And, you know, let's say the son is a first-time home buyer. Whatever allocation, the percentage is allocated of ownership to that son is what he'll be eligible for in the land transfer tax rebate. So, for instance, if he's getting 50% ownership of that property, he'll be eligible for $2,000, right?
Okay.
So as the percentages goes up, the eligibility for the rebate goes up as well.
Okay. Now, would you recommend all four people to go on title? Because sometimes they're saying that we all don't want to use our rebate.
Yeah.
That's the question. So sometimes you're like, well, no, Mateen, we, for our second property, we like to hold off. I get that a lot for some reason. I'm like, so my, what I advise to, you know, our audience and some of our clients, I would always... I tell them not to look at the rebate. I tell them to listen. If you can qualify, try to get a good mortgage with it for a very good rate. That amount of the rebate, the tax rebate, I believe is very small. So $4,000, I don't think, you know, during the 5-year period, if you get a good rate, I don't think it's, you know, it's going to make that much of a difference.
You're absolutely correct. And, you know, again, the rebate is $4,000. With the price of real estate the way that it is now, you know, single family homes, it's difficult to get something under $1 million, especially if you're looking in the GTA. And I'm inclined to agree with you. A better interest rate versus a first time home buyer rebate, you want to go for the better interest rate because that's something you're paying over 60 months. Usually terms are 5 years, 60 months. So if you can knock off a half percentage, in the long run, you're going to end up saving more money.
Absolutely.
And I'm basing this opinion on, you know, the standard purchase price of a single family home, $1 million. Most likely, depending on the amount of your mortgage, you'll probably save more money in the long run.
Okay. Perry, let's talk about a little bit about properties that are going into power of sale or foreclosure. Now, what is God forbid if someone end up going into litigation, what are their rights and what is the difference between power of sale and foreclosure? So a lot of people think that, well, it's just the bank.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So they have no idea what the difference is.
Yeah.
What's the difference between a power sale and a foreclosure?
So in its purest and most simplest form, a power of sale allows the mortgage holder to sell the home, right? So the first mortgage holder usually is the one who has a right. If the mortgage is in default, they can go ahead and sell the home. And what they'll do is basically they'll initiate the power of sale proceedings. The owner has a right of redemption. So there's certain days in which they can redeem the mortgage.
Yeah.
And again, just to cut it short, the difference is for a power of sale, the property is listed and sold. For foreclosure, usually what happens is the lender takes over the property and then does with it what is usually selling the property.
Okay. So you're saying basically that the power of sale, I'm sure they get notices, right?
That's
so
correct.
The bank send them notice and then they're like, well, I don't have the funds to keep up with my mortgage payment. Mm-hmm. So let's sell the property. But in a power of sale, if you could sell the property, mm-hmm. please correct me if I'm wrong in terms of, on your lawyer's part. So in power of sale, if you sell the property, you're allowed to keep the profit.
So yes.
But in a foreclosure, I believe you're not, right? So foreclosure, the bank will just take it and then says, that's it?
I believe your question is, as let's say, for example, for me, I own, 123 Avenue, right?
Yes.
There's a home there.
Yeah.
I've defaulted in my mortgage.
Okay.
And now the bank has sent me a notice that, hey, here's the notice of default. And in X amount of days, if this default is not cured, which is usually the case, we will go ahead and do this.
Okay.
And then I think your question is that in that circumstances, if I, as the property owner, list and sell the property for sale before the mortgagee takes over the property, do I retain the profits? Yes.
Okay.
Profits in the sense after you pay off all the encumbrances on title and you pay off any default fees which may be there, typically, the mortgagee will also charge you for any notices it sends to you, any fees it's incurred in order to enforce its mortgage. So if you get the notice and you list and sell your property within the time frame that the mortgagee has specified and the mortgagee is not in possession of your property, yes, you will retain profits if they're there, yes.
Okay, all right. Okay, great. Well, listen, thank you so much. Now, in terms of from your law firm, how long have you been practicing as a real estate lawyer?
Yeah, so I'm going on to my fourth year now.
Okay.
So I've been practicing real estate law. It's been a great industry, especially recently, as you know. It's been going up, and so I've been in the business for quite some time now. I have other lawyers at my firm; they've been in the business for over 50 years. So.
Okay. And you guys are located in downtown Toronto, right?
We're at downtown Toronto. We're at King and York. Yes.
Okay. All right. Perfect. So, what are your special what you specialize in the most? I know you do real estate law. And your law firm also does commercial law as well, right?
That's
so, real estate law is and a commercial law. It's it goes into many factors, like different channels, and it's very broad. But for yourself, I know myself and the team. We've been working with you very closely, mm-hmm. right? But what else do you specialize in besides real estate?
So what we've been doing, and I've been doing a lot now, is of litigation, but as it relates to real estate.
Okay. Litigations when it goes to power of sale and foreclosure.
Yes. So there's the power of sale process, which we're heavily involved in at my firm as well. But in terms of real estate litigation, when it comes to forfeit of deposits.
Okay.
You have instances where the purchaser was not able to close. Whether it be for financing or whatever reason, and then there's a deposit which basically is owed to the seller.
Okay.
In the usual course of business, obviously, if the circumstances are different, things will be different.
Of course.
Depending on the facts.
Okay.
So what we're seeing a lot of now is basically enforcing the agreement of purchase and sale, and getting the deposit that's owed to the seller basically paid to the seller.
Okay.
So it is unfortunate. There are some transactions that, for one reason or the other, financing or something else, do not go through.
Okay.
And then it becomes a tricky situation.
Yeah. Okay. Now, can we, let's talk about, I know we don't have much time right now. We only have half an hour, but we used most of our time.
Yeah.
Just briefly, Perry, can you tell us what, let's talk about a seller first.
Yep.
What does the seller need to look for before purchasing a home? And in terms of legality, part of it, mm-hmm. what do they need to be aware of?
Yeah, I've got, and even before we get to the purchasing of the home, when they want to first list their property, I always advise my seller clients, hey, get your real estate agent in, because he knows this very well, and ask him, what can I do to this property to get top dollar for it, right? Okay. There's very small things which need to be done, you know, paving of a driveway or just sealing a driveway, which can make the difference in $5,000 to $10,000 in the sale price. So I always recommend get your real estate agent in your property and ask him, you know, Mateen, you come to sell my house. Mateen, what can I do to get top dollar for this house? And, you know, you walk me through the process. Hey, you know, you might want to just refresh your paint. You might want to do this. You might want to do that.
Okay.
And that get you top dollar, because you're in the market every day. You know what your buyers are looking for. Correct. And you know how you can get your sellers can get top dollar. And then in terms of, I think you're alluding to if they're selling to buy, what
Correct.
The steps are there. Yeah.
Exactly.
So because the way the market is going these days, and I've noticed, maybe you have as well, a lot of people these days, they're instead of doing the sale to buy on the same day, they're doing a bridge loan now.
Okay.
Just to, you know, a bridge loan is exactly what the name insists. It's literally a bridge to get you to the other side. So typically what we're seeing a lot of nowadays versus a couple of years back was not the case. What people will do is they will sell, you know, for example, they'll sell on the 15th, and what they'll do is they'll buy on the 12th,
okay.
right? So they get a three-day bridge loan. The bank, basically the mortgage that they're going to get for the purchase, the bank gives them two mortgages. One is the regular mortgage, and the second is the bridge loan.
Okay.
The bridge loan they give to just gap that bridge of 3 days, and that gives comfort to, you know, a seller as well, because, hey, you've sold your home now. You know, you got your 3 days, you can move into your new home. A lot of times when you're doing the sale to buy, it becomes a stressful situation. You know, funds come in late. Your seller, you know, let's say, for example, I'm a lawyer representing the buyer of the property, and we're selling to buy on the same day. If anything goes wrong and I don't get funds in my trust account, I can't, you know, transfer them fast enough to do the purchase.
For sure.
So I always recommend to my clients, if you can, the right way to do it is to do the bridge loan, just so it gives you a little security cushion, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, listen, ladies and gentlemen, we don't have too much time again, but Mr. Perry is a very professional real estate lawyer. Not only he's one of our top real estate lawyers that we work with, but he's also a very dear friend. But if you guys have any questions or concerns in terms of real estate law or in a power of sale or foreclosure, if you guys want to get some information, please don't hesitate. His information is on the bottom of the screen. Please contact him if you have any questions or concern. Again, before I let you guys know, I also wanted to for next week, we're going to have one of our mortgage specialists that's going to be here with us. So if you do have any questions regarding that, you could send us an email so we could ask them the questions or concerns or stuff that you guys want or looking for. Okay? So again, Mr. Perry, thank you so much for being here. It was a pleasure having you here with us. I'm sure he will be joining us on, you know, next episodes.
Coming in the near future.
In the near future, absolutely. Okay, but is there anything else you'd like to close off before we end our show?
No, I think, Mateen, we've covered basically just, you know, small brushstrokes of what the real estate transaction involves. And it's good information, you know, for our buyers, for our sellers to know, and for your clients and my clients to know. Just so, you know, the best thing to do is make them aware of the process and keep them updated throughout the entire process, which I know you do a very good job at, and I hope I do it. You know,
well, we try. Yeah. We try to do it. You know, our job is so complex and so busy, but we always do our best to give the information out there to our audience and clients and customers. So again, we'd like to thank everybody for watching. Again, please don't hesitate to send us an email, or you could reach us with the telephone, and we're here to help. Okay? Thank you so much for watching. Again, have yourself a great night. Thank you.
Thanks.